Good. Is it still morning? Yes. Good morning, everyone. David Thomas, I'm the Vice President for Strategic Initiatives and Community Engagement at CCP. It is a pleasure to have you all here. As we've been doing this work, we cannot do this work successfully without our partners in the community, our faculty members. Malika, so good to see you. It's just an honor to have this discussion. We see ourselves as being critical to this work because every time the news talks about some gun violence, we cringe because we think, was it one of our students? How is it impacting, anyone that is part of the city's college, whether it be, again, students, staff, faculty, administrators. So we see ourselves as core to this work, and as core to getting the information out and educating the public about what we need to do about it. So again, thank you all for the work that you're doing, championing this work across the city, across the state, across the nation. We're your partners in this fight, and we're definitely here to work with you to see how we can quell this these issues in Philadelphia. And yes, good morning, Jamie. I'm seeing these remarks down there, right? So I'm 248. Good to see you. Central High School in the building, always. There you go. Dr. Jones probably like, oh no, not more Central folks. We're always here. You can't get rid of us. Thank you, everybody. Thanks, Erica.
Thanks, Dave. All right, we'll turn it over to you, Dr. Generals.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. And Erica finished up today's musical segment with Marvin Gaye's What's Going On? And I think nothing is more appropriate to today's topic than the theme that's embedded in that song. Where, good God, where's Marvin Gaye when we need him? Today's topic, of course, gun violence, a public health crisis in Philadelphia. Let me first of all thank you all for joining us on this panelist. I know Jessica will introduce everyone individually, but I want to personally thank you for joining us and helping us move this latest segment of Enough is Enough as we continue to explore important topics for the city of Philadelphia. Again, today's topic, gun violence, a public health crisis in Philadelphia. That topic, of course, is foremost on everyone's mind here who's living in Philadelphia or working in Philadelphia. Just by way of background, a few statistics to really emphasize why we are hosting this very important panel discussion. By the end of 2020, Philadelphia reported 499 homicide victims, a number that's been steadily on the rise in recent years. As of Sunday, July 11th, Philadelphia reported 294 homicide victims, up 34% compared to the total homicides from this day last year. 251 of those homicide victims died as a result of gun violence, meaning we have more than half of the total killings of last year, and we are only halfway through the year. 220 marked a 30-year record with its 420, excuse me, 2020 marked a 30-year record with its 414 individuals killed as a result of gun violence. But 2021 is on track to surpass that number to become the worst year on record. These are just some of the facts of the tragedies that our families and neighborhoods are dealing with on a daily basis. And let me take a personal note. These are just facts, but the reality, this is personal to everyone in this city. Anyone that's living in the city in fear of their own safety, or they have children, as I do, fearful of your sons and/or your daughters, this really is a personal phenomenon. And it's not unique to Philadelphia. I know we're focusing on Philadelphia, but it is a national tragedy, a national crisis that's going on that we are living through in addition to the pandemic. We see the stories of our brothers and sisters, and sadly, our children being gunned down in their own neighborhoods, whether by accident or targeted. We must come to understand that these actions have consequences and carry trauma for years to come. We also know that the media plays a critical role in shaping the narrative around gun violence in our city. And if we change the way the story of gun violence gets told and who tells it, who knows what kinds of differences we can see. We have a diverse spread of panelists who have agreed to talk with us today, and we will shed some light and educate us on this deadly epidemic we are facing throughout Philadelphia. And so now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce the moderator for today's conversation, Dr. Jessica Beard, who is the Director of Research at our proud partner, the Philadelphia Center for Gun Violence Reporting. Dr. Beard will introduce our panelists. And so with that, Dr. Beard, it's on you. It's all yours.
Thank you, Dr. Generals. Thank you so much for having me, and giving me the privilege to moderate this panel. And thank you to our attendees. Now we have 166 for joining us today for a discussion about gun violence, public health, and the role of the media. I'm a trauma surgeon and a public health researcher at Temple University Hospital, which is the busiest trauma center treating gunshot wound patients in the city. I'm also the director of research, newly appointed, for the Philadelphia Center for Gun Violence Reporting, which is at the Community College of Philadelphia, and I'm a Stone Lee Foundation Fellow. As Dr. Generals mentioned, the Philadelphia Center for Gun Violence Reporting, our aim is really to deepen the media narrative on gun violence by collaborating with journalists and local organizations to raise voices from our community and explore root causes and solutions. In 2020, the world faced a deadly pandemic, but we in Philadelphia struggled with our own uncontrolled epidemic of gun violence and were on track for our worst year on record. Today, we want to talk about expanding our solutions to match the scale of this problem. And we have an incredible group of panelists. I'm going to introduce them now. We have Dr. Ruth Abaya, who's an attending at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. She's an emergency medicine physician. She's a Stone Lee Foundation Fellow, and she is the Injury Prevention Program Manager at the City Department of Health. We have Council Member Jamie Gauthier from the 3rd District, who is a native of West Philadelphia and an incredible advocate for gun violence prevention. We have Manuel McDonald Smith, who is a managing editor at CBS3 Eyewitness News and the immediate past president of the Philadelphia Association of Black Journalists. We have Dr. Dorothy Johnson Spite, who is the founder and national executive director of Mothers in Charge. And last but not least, we have Professor Malika Rahman, who is faculty at the Community College of Philadelphia in criminal justice. So you can see we have an incredibly diverse and esteemed panel, and let's get right into the questions. I just wanna mention that we're going to go through some questions and you all can answer. Some of them will be sort of directed at you know, certain panelists, but everyone can answer. And then at around 11:45 or so, I'm going to accept questions from the Q&A. So please put your questions in the Q&A box. And there we go. Submit our questions. So first up, kind of really the focus of this panel, which is gun violence as a public health problem. What does it mean to approach gun violence as a public health problem? And how is that the same or different to what we're already doing in the city of Philadelphia? Maybe Dr. Abaya wants to tell us about that.
Yeah, I'm happy to start that one off. So thank you so much, Jessica, for the introduction and for having us on this panel. I am always excited to have an opportunity to kind of talk about reframing gun violence as a public health issue for a number of reasons. So as far as what the definition of that means, so there are some formal definitions that are worth being cognizant of. The CDC has a diagram that many of you may have seen that talks about how do you look at violence or any other issue as a public health crisis. And it starts from kind of understanding the problem well, which is a fundamental and key part. So that really speaks to the data that helps you understand what the drivers and what the actual deterrents are that are effective, to all the way to identifying solutions that you then measure the outcomes of, and then you implement and scale to effect. So that's the general trajectory of a public health model. I think that there are pieces of that that are important to pull out. The first is really understanding what the problem is. So, of course, the fundamental problem is that people are losing their lives. And in addition to that, people are being traumatized and having long-standing physical ailments as a result of their exposure to gun violence, and communities are being traumatized. So that's the problem we want to fix. But what are the drivers of, what are the true drivers of that problem? That's a place where I think there's a lot of room to improve our understanding, because any solutions that we actually design need to speak to what really is driving that. And so I think that there have been a lot of narratives kind of in the public space over the last kind of several decades around gun violence. Is it driven by just an inclination towards criminal behavior? Because that's going to be treated in one way. Or is it driven by chronic lack of opportunity and disinvestment? That's going to be treated a completely different way, right? So an understanding of what actually can we link scientifically to gun violence? Can we really link a baseline level of criminal behavior? Is there evidence for that? Or are we really making that assumption? And what are some of the biases that inform that assumption that we need to confront kind of head on? And then if we recognize that when we see places where there's a lot of investment and a lot of opportunity, we don't see a lot of gun violence, that yields a kind of completely different way to kind of fix the problem that results in asset building and in actually changing communities from the inside out over time. I'm going to say something that's not always popular, but I think I say it as every opportunity I have. Some of the solutions to fixing gun violence permanently in our solutions or in our communities rather are multi-year solutions. So we need to be willing to invest in things that are not only going to reduce the violence on the street today, which is critical and important, but are going to make it so we're not having this conversation 20 years from now, 30 years from now. There are things we could have done in the 90s that would have made it very different right now in 2021. And they involve investment. And so I think that a public health solution takes a really more broad scoping view of what the drivers are before we get to the point where we're implementing solutions and scaling them. We really need to look at what the data actually tells us about those drivers. And I'll stop. I'll get off my soapbox.
Are there any other there we go. Council member Gauthier.
I wanted to address the second part of your question about how is addressing gun violence from a public health perspective different or the same as what we're doing now. So I think as a city, we are getting better at approaching gun violence from a public health perspective. A few years ago, we developed the roadmap to safer communities, which is our strategy for undertaking that work. And Dr. Abaya and others at the health department are key to that work. But I see that we still have a long way to go in terms of really investing in this approach. One area where I think we could do much better is data. And making improvements in the way that the city gathers data about gun violence and shares that data with the rest of our city. I think that data about where shootings are happening and our analysis of those shootings could be made more accessible to lay people. I like to liken it to the way we've approached COVID with respect to the city's COVID dashboard and all of the information that we released on COVID. We have charts and graphs that allow you to track what's actually happening in real time. And I think we could do the same thing with gun violence. And I wanna point out that Dr. Abaya and her team are doing truly incredible and groundbreaking work within the health department to make data available to the public and to analyze this data. But I think we could expand that work dramatically. And I'd like to see, the mayor invest and grow these efforts in a way that I think will allow us to understand gun violence better and tailor our prevention and interventions better as well. And then I'd also add, I think we have a long way to go in believing the data, believing what the data is telling us and investing accordingly. For years, we've known that there are specific root causes that lead to gun violence. For years, we've known that neighborhoods that are the most disinvested have the most issues or see the most occurrences of gun violence. But we've stubbornly continued to put much more in investment in enforcement than we are willing to put in investments in people and in neighborhoods. And so I think our city will move further when we actually believe what the data is telling us and shift our budget to match what the data is telling us.
Thank you so much for that comment. And as a public health researcher, I completely agree. And it's one of the kind of main challenges that we have in the study and in the monitoring of gun violence as data. So it's certainly a great place to start when you're addressing gun violence as a public health problem. Do any of our other panelists have any comments about what it means to address gun violence as a public health problem?
I'd like to make a brief comment. Hi, this is Dr. Dorothy Johnson Spike, Mothers in Charge, working with mothers, grandmothers, women who've lost children and loved ones to violence. Marvin said it best, too many moms are crying, too many loved ones are dying. We have to look at it as a public health epidemic. It is the leading cause of death among African-American males 14 to 34. It's not some incurable disease. It's nothing but homicide that is leading the cause of death among that group of individuals. We have to treat it the same way, as it was said earlier, as if it's a public health epidemic, it's a crisis. Treating it the same way that we've done COVID or opioid, putting money and investments in the community to address it as an epidemic. We can't look at it as, you know, more police involved necessarily to make this go away. There's got to be real investments to address the issues as if it's a public health crisis. Leading cause of death, nothing else, for African-American males 14 to 34.
Professor Rahman, I think you had something to say as well.
I do, just to highlight, I think what Dr. Abaya, Councilmember Gaultier has really said, but needs to just kind of be reinforced, is that yes, the data is important, but I think we also have to talk about the detriment, right? The question is ultimately the answer. It says, what does it mean to approach gun violence? We have to approach it. We can't keep talking over it. And I think that is one of the highlights that Councilmember Gaultier was saying, is that we have to get into it. And this notion of just talking about what it is, right? We know, and the facts speak for themselves, but what are we going to do about it? There are physical, emotional, and mental effects of gun violence on the community. It's not just let's read about it and acknowledge it, but we have to be willing to get in, assess, and address it. And what that looks like is really understanding that it has a traumatic effect on not just the people who are victims of it, not just on the mothers and the grandmothers, but on the community that has to support mothers in charge, on the communities. Mothers are comforting their sons who are losing friends to gun violence in 2021. That's a real thing. Our students at CCP are losing family members daily, and they're having to be faced with not just the COVID pandemic, but how do I maintain my family if it's my children's father, if it's my own parent? How do I now deal with the effects of this while still having to live my life? So when we talk about the data, yes, the data is important, but if we are not going to address the detriment that gun violence is having on our community, then all we're going to keep doing is crunching numbers. So we have to, yes, acknowledge and assess, analyze the data, but let's as a community be willing to address it. And that means get in it. So if that means the mayor needs to put money into it, let's do it. If that means that we have to actively support organizations like Mothers in Charge and others who are doing the work, let's do that. But let's keep having these open conversations and not just sitting back and saying, you know what? Yes, it's a problem. Yes, it's making us sad. Yes, it's making us physically sick. People are walking around depressed and in fear because they don't want to come outside, because the likelihood that one could get shot in an inner city neighborhood in Philadelphia is high. This is not some false narrative. The likelihood that women can lose their sons, fathers can lose their sons, is high. They are not operating out of a false narrative. So it needs to not just be analyzed and assessed, but we need to openly address it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that comment, Professor. And you know, certainly, you know, for me, it's an everyday thing. I actually don't look forward to the summer, right? Because it's so incredibly, incredibly overwhelming and frankly traumatizing to keep doing this every day. So we're all in this together. I think that kind of segues well into our next question, which is kind of digging deeper into what it means to explore gun violence as a public health problem. And my question is, maybe for each of you, if you could choose one ideally evidence-based gun violence prevention intervention to invest in for Philadelphia, what would it be? How much would it cost? And how would you measure its impact?
Let me jump in on that one first. And first, thanks everybody for CCP for inviting me on to today's panel, and the fact that there's 219 people here in the middle of a morning on a Thursday shows how important this issue is. I want to speak kind of like a little bit more for some personal background though. Like, you know, listen, I grew up here in the city, you know, so I'm a Black man and a Black father. Like, you know, so this violence epidemic is real. And Professor Rahman, what you said was absolutely important, right? This is a public health problem. The issues to solving this will be complex, but what does it feel like today? And is there immediate impact? last night, I just got finished approving a script. You know, there was somebody shot on except the bus in the middle of the night. Who's on the bus at the middle of the night? 15 other people who, not because they're out joyriding on the bus, it's because that's how they get to work. And now I've got a fear of going to work the next day. I'm nervous about my mom going to work or my dad getting home or my kids who are on that bus in the middle of the night. And what emotional impact does that have? So when we have these bigger discussions, I kind of feel like, hey, how do we cover it as a public health crisis? That's important. But what's happening today? We mentioned the coverage of COVID and the opioid crisis, and you can kind of see some responses in that way. But if this is a gun violence emergency, I'm just, as a journalist, it's hard to see it feel like an emergency. Like, we don't see an emergency command center or an immediate community response. And some of that, I think, in the sense of like coverage, it's kind of hard to cover that. It's hard to say, hey, this is a public health crisis, or show that it's a public health crisis when there is a mass shooting event on July 4th, but officials don't have a press conference until 2 or 3 days later. It's hard to show that, you know, listen, I think I counted maybe like, there were 7 people shot in the span, I think, between Sunday and Monday, all in double, triple shooting events. And the police are doing their job and responding, but no one else is. Like, you know what I mean? So how do I put that in context? How does the community feel? Hey, something is happening that's very unusual. And when there is no overall response or coordination of response in that level, then it kind of feels like, you know what? Maybe it's not important. Maybe your life doesn't matter. Maybe we all just accept that this level of violence is normal and okay. And maybe, you know, if I'm feeling some type of way, other people don't care about me.
That's incredibly important commentary, Manny. And I think that it really highlights what I'm hearing from you. The question was, what are approaches to gun violence that would address it as a public health problem? What I'm hearing from you is you want to talk about it as a public health problem, but you're not necessarily seeing the infrastructure that we are using to address it as a public health problem, if that makes sense. Is that kind of what you were saying?
And getting back to specifically what you asked, I remember as a young man, Operation Safe Streets. And I think that people have gone back and forth about whether or not that really led to a decline in crime. But I remember police officers at the corner. I remember my parents feeling better about making their way to the trolley stop in West Philly, especially at late hours and early in the morning, because they saw some physical response to what was, you know, a growing violence epidemic. So I think that people, if we would do something, to me, in my personal opinion, I think something like that is probably appropriate at this level.
So I will just say that what you're describing is a law enforcement approach to gun violence. Maybe not necessarily what we're talking about, which was a public health approach to gun violence. You know, that's kind of how we've handled it previously, but are there kind of new ways, are there new programs or new interventions that we can talk about too?
I don't think it's a sole solution. I think in that immediate sense though of hey, you know what, if people are scared, that's real, that's an emotion. Like, you know, people feel like nothing's being done, that's real, it's emotion right now. We know the problem's gonna be bigger, but it's, you know, it's almost like, hey, when you go to the doctor's office, you know what I mean? You know, I might have serious health issues going on, but can you give me an aspirin right now? And I think that's how people.
Well, and I actually, if I could just make one comment on that, I think that's a great analogy in order to kind of really understand what we're talking about, right? So I'm a trauma surgeon, I'm a doctor. I deal with what is at the distal most point of this problem, which is, you know, I operate on gunshot wound victims and I save their lives, but I don't prevent gun violence. That's the job of public health, right? So like, that's the way I understand it too, right? Law enforcement deals with the effects of gun violence, but how are we gonna actually get at preventing gun violence, right? I know that within kind of my everyday practice of medicine, I'm not gonna prevent gun violence. So let's start talking about what are things that can actually get at some of those root causes. And maybe in your case, Manny, it's actually just talking about the root causes and changing that narrative so that people begin to understand that it's not this, you know, within the realm of criminology, but it can actually be in the realm of, you know, development and public health.
Yeah, if I could jump in, I love this question. I think that there are a couple things that are worth lifting up as specific public health solutions that are showing promise around the country that have good data as far as how much they cost and how cost effective they are. And they are similar in a couple of ways. So I'm thinking about two models. One is called Advanced Peace, which started out in California. The other is called Ready, which is a Chicago-based model based in the Heartland Alliance. They have a lot of, they're different programs, but they have a lot of similarities. One similarity is that they focus on the highest risk individuals. So people who have been in the system and need to be brought out of the system, need to be given a road to productivity to fulfill all of the kind of different possible positive contributions that they can bring into society. And there's good data to suggest that focusing efforts make sense, kind of from a public health standpoint, that if you are targeted in your approach, because most people are never gonna pick up a gun and most people are never gonna shoot. If you focus on people who are at the highest risk of exposure to violence in either direction, that's a very both cost-effective and practical way to approach it. So both of those interventions are similar in that way. They focus on the highest risk. They're also similar in that they are providing an actual way forward. So I would argue that incarceration is not a way forward. And I think that, you know, obviously there's a role for law enforcement, but I think that it's not a way to kind of bring someone into their full potential and put them back into community, giving everything they have to give to make their communities better. These types of programs are like fellowships. They provide an opportunity, usually a long engagement, up to a year, sometimes more, in which they provide people with job training, with paid employment, and then with therapy, which is a piece that we don't talk about enough sometimes in our community, specifically cognitive behavioral therapy, a form of therapy that's helped to reframe how you think and therefore how you act, and has been specifically as an independent intervention shown to reduce violence. So they group all these. That's the other similarity between these programs. They don't do one thing. They don't just provide a job. They don't just provide therapy. They try to kind of be more comprehensive, and it's not a one and done. They're working with these people day in and day out for a year. And so that's why their, you know, preliminary data suggests that their outcomes are effective. As far as cost, so they have done some cost analyses. And so, for example, an Advanced Peace model costs about, you know, less than $1 million to run for 2 years. And I think when you think about cost, you have to think about, and you know, that would be different from city to city and how it depends on how you implement the model. But when you think about cost, you have to think about what are you preventing? It's not just about how much the program costs. It's also about how much gun violence is already costing us and what's already being done. And those costs, some of them are immeasurable, right? So we can talk about hospital costs and we can talk about, you know, work years lost and things like that. But how do you measure someone's chronic trauma? How do you measure the loss of someone's father? And so when you think about, you know, $500,000 a year, really hard to get excited about that number when you think about what gun violence is costing our communities. So I lift those two programs up because I think they're cost-effective. I think that they are comprehensive. They deal with the highest risk individuals and they've got preliminary data suggesting they're effective. And I think it makes sense to think about investing in those.
Can I offer something as well? So I wanted to offer up or lift up hospital-based intervention. It already exists on a small scale here in Philadelphia, but I think it should be dramatically expanded. Hospital-based intervention programs are targeted at young people and others who have been violently injured by gun violence, but this program goes to work immediately after they've been hospitalized. The interventions begin at the client's bedside and continue on with community-based care in the months after the injury. And the reason why that's important is because public health specialists think of this period of time when someone is hospitalized as a teachable moment or a golden hour for getting through to them and pulling them out of the cycle of violence. And in the immediate aftermath of, you know, a traumatic gun violence event, victims are
particularly receptive to making changes in their lives and altering their paths in a way that can prevent future injury or retaliatory violence. And so it marks a critical turning point, particularly for vulnerable youth, where, you know, they're either, they might be thinking about retaliation for the violence committed against them, but it's also an opportunity where they can turn their traumatic experience into a reason to take themselves out of, you know, the gun violence equation. And these programs have been rigorously evaluated and have demonstrated promising results across a range of outcomes, including preventing re-injury, preventing further violent crime, preventing involvement with the justice system, substance abuse, and decreasing PTSD. And there also have been studies of these types of programs, you know, against folks who didn't receive this type of intervention. And they've been shown to be successful in a range of areas. There was also a study from Drexel that suggests that an intervention program serving 90 clients could result in cost savings from tens of thousands of dollars and up to about $4 million over a 5-year period. And so I see this as a critical way to stop the revolving door of gun violence, because once you're involved in violence, even if you're just a witness to it, you're significantly more likely to be involved in violence again. So this type of intervention really would provide our city with a way of stopping the cycle of violence for people and helping them to find, you know, a different path. I would have to explore more to learn of the cost to expand these interventions. I will say that in the FY22 budget, City Council put in $500,000 towards the health department to help them expand their data collection efforts around gun violence, but to also have the public health department serve a role in expanding hospital-based interventions from a few hospitals to multiple hospitals within our city. And I think we'll have to work with those hospitals to see, you know, what those specific costs are. But I would recommend us doing this as, you know, as an intervention. I'll just give you one anecdote. There was a young man in my district, 16 years old. He was shot. He went into the hospital. He came out of the hospital. He was shot again in less than a 2-week period. And so we have to do a better job of intervening with people while, you know, while we have the opportunity to, and helping to break the cycle of violence that way.
I just wanted to second that and just say that, you know, there are some estimates that suggest that we're talking about a few $1,000s per patient. So talk about a worthwhile investment.
Absolutely. And I think it's complicated. The hospital-based violence intervention program is certainly a piece of this puzzle. I think it's a little bit of a challenge because we are dealing, remember that we're dealing with the victims of gun violence. And so how we, you know, when somebody gets re-injured due to gun violence, it's not necessarily something that you can empower them not to happen, right? If we're talking about what are the sort of root causes of gun violence and the structural causes of gun violence and the, you know, place-based risks that exist. But certainly that's an important piece of the puzzle. But I just want to kind of again point that out, that the traditional measure of the hospital-based violence intervention program has been violent re-injury. And I do have some kind of concerns with that being sort of the outcome of such a program. And I do also think that though it's very important and it happens at the level of the hospital, more proximal interventions are also necessary and need to go hand in hand.
I'm only offering this as a tool, and obviously we need to have a spectrum of prevention and intervention measures, and hopefully most of them are geared towards people not getting shot in the first place.
Professor Rahman, I saw you wanting to say something.
I did, thank you. So I'm gonna be honest with you. This question really concerned me both as a criminal justice educator and a law enforcement professional, because the way the question is worded, it presumes that there's only one answer. It says, if you could choose one evidence-based practice, we can't, right? And I think Dr. Abaya said that in the beginning of her answer, there is not one mechanism, there is not one practice that will fix this all, right? Because all practices are not and have not been proven to be readily effective in communities like Philadelphia, right? So when we look at taking pieces of the puzzle and putting them together, if we look at the three prongs of evidence-based practice, which need to be kind of the foundation for any program that is established, is prevention, intervention, right? And then utilizing that to then develop what we can predict, right? And I believe that you stated that, Dr. Beard, is if we're looking at what can happen, right? So the Chicago-based program does a great job at looking at who's likely to commit gun violence, who's likely to be a victim, but Philadelphia had that program years ago. It was called Focused Deterrence. And for those of us who have been active in the community, we know what Focused Deterrence was set up to do and then what it actually did. And here we are a few years later at the same thing, having the same conversation. So not just highlighting who is likely to be shot or who is likely to commit or be involved in a shooting, but now what happens that we know that? Now that we've identified you, how can we now bring resources into the community in which you live? Because let's be honest, Dr. Beard, the gun victims that you see who are shot in your trauma unit go home. They don't get relocated. They're not moving to some safer neighborhood. They're going back to the very neighborhood in which they live. So if it is likely that I could have been shot in January and I get shot in February and you send me back home in March, what is it to say the likelihood that I won't be shot again? Right? So if we're not investing in the community, if we're not saying, okay, listen, we know that the community resources that we had here years ago aren't here anymore, then let's put the money back into the rec centers. Let's put the money back into the communal programs who will teach our youth conflict resolution. Because from a statistical standpoint, the reason why homicides are at such a high level is because we don't teach conflict resolution anymore. It's plain and simple. Our people are failing to communicate effectively with each other. They are being triggered by their own trauma, and then we're telling them to go outside and make a life for themselves. Engage in the world and figure out how to deal with the disrespect, to deal with you telling people to man up and handle it yourselves, because these are real factors. So if we don't, when we talk about one evidence-based practice, it's not one. It's not one, right? It is a collaboration and a complexity of multi-agencies, of multi-effects, of multi-factors in examining certain things. We can't targeted one way. And I don't want the people who are listening to us and are part of this conversation based on that question to think that we all have to come up with one thing, because when we begin to think like that, it creates a separation, right? It creates the separation that Dr. Abaya and Dr. Beard have to figure it out in their world. Dr. Spite has to figure it out in her world. Emmanuel Smith have to figure it out in his world. That's not how it works. We all have to come together and figure out how to put money back into the community, put money back into the places where our youth are, and not just run job fairs down the street and tell their moms that hope would they come and run gun buybacks every other month and say, hey, we hope that you come by. Because let's talk about the reality of this. If we identify that five young men in the community are likely to be shot, what is the likelihood that they're going to come and turn that gun in for a ShopRite gift card? Slim to none.
So, Professor, I think maybe there's just a little bit of a misunderstanding, and I think that your point is very well taken, that this is a very complex problem that requires multiple solutions. There's certainly no one solution. So I thank you for pointing that out. I do, as a scientist,
I'm sorry, Dr. Beard, you said misunderstanding about what, though, just so I can-
I think for the purposes of discussion, I think it's important to kind of get down to the specifics of certain things that we know are evidence-based that may work. And so that's kind of where the question came from of not one. I mean, Dr. Abaya offered two, mm-hmm. And right now we're talking about sort of areas in which we have expertise. So yours may be, you know, within the realm of criminal justice. Mine would be within the realm of public health. And I know the literature on hospital-based violence intervention programs, and I know what they look like around the country and have seen them. So I think maybe we're just, obviously we're all here to work together, and we know that this is that requires kind of complex solutions, but at the same time, you know, we're not experts in everything. So that's kind of where, you know, cause we have this wonderful panel with people with different areas of expertise. I was hoping maybe each of us could offer, you know, our recommendations based on our expertise.
And I think I did, just so that we are clear, so there is no misunderstanding with anyone, I believe that I did offer that when I said that the focus base has to be the prediction, prevention, and intervention mechanisms, right? Those have to be the founding factors. And those can be employed in any evidence-based practice that we find is necessary or most useful after reviewing several of them, because again, there is not one. So it was not to take away from anything that was offered, but to make an understanding and provide the information and access to information that there are several that exist that we would need to review and then be in a space where we can all come together and say, let's take apart from this and apart from this so that we can address the full complex issue.
I'd like to also add, investing in the community is going to be key. And evidence-based programs, I think they get more hype oftentimes. There are organizations on the ground every day that are doing excellent work. And because they haven't been able to crunch the numbers or show the data, they get no support or no recognition. But they're in it. They can't leave it. They're committed to it. They need to also have a voice at the table. Sure, we've got hospital-based programs and we've got cure violence and they've been able with the dollars that they have and the resources that they have to show whatever it is that they want to show. Now, and while we know that there are programs across this country that are evidence-based that are working, because the data tells us that, well, I even have the question why we haven't even looked at that and invested in that, if that's what you think is the answer. But I agree, it's prevention, intervention and education across the board, and especially having those who are impacted by violence at the table. I used to go to a juvenile medical examiner's meeting every month to look at the juveniles that were murdered in the city of Philadelphia. Everybody was at that table. DHS was there, the school district was there, the medic that scooped them off the ground was there. Everybody knew back to their grandmother what their history had been. But if they knew that, why couldn't they save that 15-year-old's life? Sometimes the data is not all that you need. I'm just saying.
Can I pick
300 up? 300 murders almost this year in the city of Brotherly Love. And we don't have an answer. We can't come together with an answer. There's something real wrong with that.
I wanted to pick up from Dr. Spite. Actually, Councilman Gaultier, it's something we covered last year. There was a unfortunate case, and it's a shame that I can't remember the young man's name, but he was 6 or 7 years old. He was killed in a homicide. Of course, there was the big city reaction. And so with the neighbors,
Amar Jones.
Yes. And so with the neighbors,
Amar Jones.
Yes. And so what the neighbors came back and said, and I remember covering this as a story, was that they wanted speed bumps, that they felt the first problem to control the community was the cars coming too fast through their streets. That's how they felt what they needed to help control their block a little bit better. So I kind of get in the conversation, yes, we're looking at evidence-based practices, we're doing long-term investments, but it's still small conversations that matter. Those neighbors who were most affected by that particular shooting said, this is what will help us stop the crime. And I think that if we look at that, and I think that's what Malika and Dr. Johnson are especially saying, is like, hey, let's let the neighbors tell us what they need first, because that may be some of the most effective solutions in the longer term.
And just how do you actually operationalize, this is a little now off of our topic, but how do you actually operationalize the neighbors giving the solutions? Like, what does that look like, you know, in terms of kind of what are the next steps here?
I'm going to defer to the community experts on that, but it's a really good question. How do you operationalize that?
I mean, you talk to them, right? You talk to them, you engage them, you believe them. And the thing, what you pointed out, Manny, is that, or what part of what you point out is that the same neighborhoods that we see inundated with gun violence are the same neighborhoods where there's a housing crisis. They're the same neighborhoods where our schools are falling down. They're the same neighborhoods where parks and recreation centers haven't been invested in decades. They're the same neighborhoods where there are always traffic accidents because they don't have safe infrastructure, right? And they're the same neighborhoods where residents have been complaining about these same issues for years and years and years with no one being responsive to them. And so if we're to take an approach that gun violence in the city of Philadelphia is an emergency, we would have one, more engagement with those communities to hear their concerns and what it is that they want to happen. But we will also have a better and higher level of coordination among the agencies that serve neighborhoods in our city. And we would make sure that the investments that we're making in neighborhoods are prioritized to those neighborhoods that need the services the most. So that means that neighbors aren't banging their heads asking for street improvements over and over again. They're getting them because this is one of our high priority neighborhoods. That means that neighbors aren't fighting with LNI about problem properties that they see connected to gun violence because that neighborhood is prioritized and we're making that investment when they ask for it. So I think it's about engagement, but it's also about the way that we prioritize our resources and have agencies coordinate as the city of Philadelphia.
I want to dig a little bit deeper into this sort of tension between what is sort of the kind of neighborhood response and this evidence base. I think this was what Professor Rahman was talking about, and I'd like to talk a little bit more about it. Like, how do you make sure what you're doing at a grassroots level is working if there are challenges to evaluate what you're doing? And that kind of gets back to, you know, operationalizing the community response.
So I think, I'm sorry, Dr. Abaya. I think Dr. Abaya said this quite early on in her message, and she said, how do we measure trauma, right? So if the question is still how we measure trauma, then we have to apply the same question to how we're going to measure the response to trauma, right? So I get where you're coming from and I appreciate it, but it's almost as if, again, and Dr. Spite said this, that you expect the community to crunch the numbers in a way that is relatable and understandable in terms of something that is not that easy, simplified, for instance, right? So let's say the work that is being done by Mothers in Charge, right? When we talk about evidence-based practice, can Mothers in Charge formulate a curriculum, formulate a program that is prediction-based, based on what we know about the facts, based on what we know about the evidence of who is likely to be committing violence or be a victim of gun violence? The answer to that is yes, i.e. the statistics, right? What is the age bracket that we need to target? Black men in inner city communities, age 18 to 34. That's something that can be measurable if we're looking at these men who we're helping, right? If we're looking at, is the prevention working? If we're going into these specific communities and we're implementing certain programs, programs that are evidence-based in terms of cognitive therapy, right? Where we're getting men who perhaps may be incarcerated or have been incarcerated or shot or will likely be shot. And we're trying to change the trajectory of how they think. That is something that can be measured, right? But it's not going to be measured in a sense of, did they get shot yesterday? Did they get shot in 5 years? Because if we're working on a specific group, we have to measure that group. Now, if we're saying community conversations, to Councilmember Gaudier's point, if we're going into the community, that's measurable. How? Because I'm addressing the targeted concerns of this community, and then I'm looking at my impact. What is my impact? Are the changes that they're requesting something as simple as speed bumps? Are they being addressed? The answer to that is yes. So guess what that's doing? That's settling down the nerve of the community and it's building the trust in the community members, stakeholders, and leaders, right? Okay, so let's say we operation safe streets. No, it may not be the most effective, but is it going to give people a sense of safety in the communities in which they live? Yes. When people have a sense of safety, are they likely to engage more in the community in which they live? Yes. Are they likely to trust the people who are monitoring their community? Yes. What does that do? That builds trust, opens the lines of communication. These are all things that can be measured. It may not be as simple as placing it on an Excel spreadsheet, but it can actively be measured in how we engage with our people and then what that looks like from a stakeholder perspective. Can Councilmember Gaudier say that when I engage with my community, when I address their concerns, it built trust and it changed some things? That is a yes. And she can measure that as effectiveness in her role. So when we talk about measuring community, I think we have to also shift our perspective of what it looks like and kind of open ourselves up to it not looking like a specific data sheet and maybe looking different when we engage with people.
Dr. Beard, let me give you a real life example and even a personal one. I was talking to a friend who's running a community summer jobs program, and she was saying, hey, she's having a tough time actually getting enough kids filled into the role because their parents have concerns about them using transit. In my own home this week, my daughter has opportunity to participate in a summer program at Drexel University. And I'm speaking because we're talking about public health. But, you know, it's a real discussion in my house. Hey, are we okay with her at 15 years old taking public transit to and from Mount Airy to that event because of the level of violence in this city? And so it's almost like, in a sense, I think we're having that discussion at a point. Yes, I think that we have amazing public health experts who are going to be at the table and ready to give those resources. But is the level of safety just so out of control that people can't even get there, that people don't want to access it, don't want to come out to have that discussion because there's that level of immediate safety that's not being addressed?
I want to also add community involvement that was discussed earlier, and community trust also brings about empowerment. Our communities don't feel empowered. They don't think that anything is going to change because they don't have a voice. So engaging them in the community, in the community conversations about the change that they feel they need and want to see, that almost becomes contagious in that, well, maybe this can make a difference. Maybe I can be a part of this. Maybe I can have a voice because I know something that may be able to be helpful in this situation. So that's the importance of having the community involved. You know, they need to feel empowered that a change is possible. And right now, the reason you mentioned that there seems to be no real, you know, uprising with the folks in the community about doing anything because they don't think anything can be done because they're not a part of anything. We try to engage our community, our victims, our supporters, but oftentimes they're so devastated by the trauma that they aren't a lot of help in terms of doing what needs to be done. So everyone needs to be at the table with a voice, and everybody can do something. And when you feel anybody, if you feel you're making a difference, you feel empowered. And that needs to be across the board in terms of becoming contagious almost. And then you begin to see change and you begin to see hope. Right now, we don't have a lot of hope.
Yeah, I completely agree with everything that's been said. I think the first step is one of humility. I think the people who give grants and the people who assess programs need to recognize that we don't know what we don't know. And so there is a lot of effective work where people are so busy doing the work that they don't have the bandwidth, the capacity, the personnel to then, you know, provide arbitrary measurements to another body because they, you know, they've got relationships with people on the ground that they need to maintain. So I think there's been a recognition of that. In recent years, we've seen a lot of criticisms of websites like crimesolutions.gov. Recognizing that they're skewed towards certain types of solutions and certain types of people who are able to provide the data that kind of counts. So I think that there definitely needs to be some humility in the world of both kind of those who give grants and also academia about what we know and what we don't know. But I think it's an either and approach, right? We also have to capacity build. So there have been a lot of conversations about this recently. There's lots of knowledge and personnel in the city of Philadelphia that can be brought to, you know, can be brought to service in communities where people are doing good work, right? They don't need to do those things by themselves. There are lots of people on the ground in the city of Philadelphia and all our academic institutions and other places who are, you know, extremely facile with an Excel spreadsheet. And I think it's our, you know, collective duty to provide that expertise and that support for those who are doing the work of keeping our community safe, but don't have the ability or the capacity or the time, frankly, to do it themselves. And so I think a better collaboration between those worlds is another solution.
Thank you so much for this incredible conversation. And I think that Dr. Abaya really hit it a potential, you know, and I know that you're working on that, Dr. Abaya, is making those connections and supporting community initiatives. I'm going to look in the Q&A because we have about 6 minutes left, and I'm going to see if we have any questions, and folks can put in some questions in the Q&A. We didn't really talk so much about media because we had just such an incredibly interesting conversation about solutions. Here's a question that says, what do you think local media outlets are missing when it comes to reporting on the gun violence epidemic? Is there a narrative that is missing, or do you imagine a more responsible way that this epidemic can be reported from a public health perspective? Maybe Manny, and it looks like council member.
I want to answer the question honestly, but why don't I think the question was proposed as to what can we do better. It might be more appropriate maybe two of the other panelists go first and I can come back and respond.
I'd like to add something. I think oftentimes when the reporting is done, it's a very sensitive time. We've had this conversation before with some other journalists. Trauma training for the journalists and the reporters to understand how to approach a family who has just learned that their loved one has been murdered. I understand there's not a lot of trauma training that's been given to journalists to even understand what that family, that individual may be going through, what they're experiencing at the moment, to be able to know how to approach them, if it's even the right time to approach. You know, you don't want to stick a mic in front of somebody's face when, you know. So, and the other part of that is to not only report, we know what the problem is. All we hear is gun violence, shooting, no witness, no apprehension. What about some resources for those families that are listening, that are watching? Where can you direct them to go get help? Why not make that a part of your reporting? A lot of families don't know where to turn when they've never experienced this before, don't know where to go. That should be a part of the reporting. Here's a number you can call. Here's a place you can call. When there's a suicide, a number comes on, 1-800-CALL-SUICIDE for help and support. We don't get that with homicides. And I think families in the community needs to know where they can go to get help, or even where they can go to get involved to make a difference, as well as we talked about engaging the community.
I agree with everything that Dr. Johnson-Spite said, and I would just add that I think I would like to see the media cover this issue in a deeper way, and that's not a shot. I mean, Manny is actually one of the, you know, journalists that or reporters that actually, you know, really are stepping up in this area and being proactive. But most of the reporting we see is very basic and just about, you know, who, what, when, where, when in reality, you know, these are traumatic incidents for not even just for the person who was shot and their loved ones, but for entire communities. And so I think it's important that the media share information about specific incidents, but also that they deepen the narrative around gun violence and create awareness about the complex nature of the issue and, you know, the urgency for all Philadelphians to be invested in finding solutions, as well as like what's behind these shootings, what are the causes and risk factors, and what, you know, has gone on in these neighborhoods where we're seeing so many shootings happen. I think covering this in just a basic way just perpetuates the idea that some neighborhoods are safe, some neighborhoods are not, and it doesn't help us as a city to come up with more complex, comprehensive solutions.
I think those are amazing insights, and I want to say you guys are spot on the money, right? The journal, we at the media, and I'm saying this not only as CBS3, but as a former president of the Association of Black Journalists in Philly, we can do better. And I think the conversation, though, in the sense is that we want to do better. Shout out to Dr. Beard and to Dr. Generals and CCP for even housing like a center for better gun violence reporting, because I don't think this is a discussion that we've ever had, because if we wanted to attack some of those issues, where would I go? Now you guys are actually forming this discussion, and I think it's important. And it's important, I think it's a big deal on the behalf of my station management to say, hey, Manny, clear the deck and be there to be part of it. Dr. Spite brought up the idea of the open gun violence resources. That wasn't a big Manny Smith idea. We did that because of the Center for Gun Violence Reporting. All of our web stories, we add that in there now. We're actually talking about ways of expanding that list, making it more interactive and making some more impact on television. Hopefully I can talk more about that, how we'll do that in the future. When we talk about proactive reporting, we can be better. every day we take time in our meetings to ask discussions about that. Listen, the mayor's not gonna have a nice afternoon. He's having a press conference today about play streets. But we're gonna cover that, and that's important, that's interesting. But you know what? I think sometime between today and tomorrow, unfortunately, the city's gonna reach 300 homicides. That's what we're there to ask about. Like, you know, where are the answers? Where are the solutions? Is this all you have? That's what I wanna know. We did something yesterday at the city council president's event about gun buybacks, not to put down the effectiveness of gun buybacks. But again, when you have 10,000 people who were shot in the city since 2015, is this the right answer? Is this the main thing you're working on? And so those complex answers is what we're getting at. I want to say, number one, that all of you guys keep coming to the table. Keep giving those ideas. When we get it right, we like to hear it, but when we get it wrong, like, let us know exactly what we need to be covering, what we're missing, and what we can do to support your efforts.
I also wanted to point out that it's up to us to provide the media with a richer set of data. And I wanted to give a shout out to Jim McMillan and the Philadelphia Center for Gun Violence Reporting for helping to shift that dynamic.
Amen to that.
All right, I think it's noon. So on that note, I think we'll close our panel. I've really enjoyed our conversation. It was extremely eye-opening. I appreciate all of our panelists' viewpoints and honesty and the discussion. And thank you so much to CCP for hosting this panel.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Panelists, thank you so much, Dr. Beard. Thank you for your time and your ability to facilitate. This was such a rich discussion, and we are excited to host this discussion and look forward to the next discussion, because we clearly see an hour wasn't enough. But we thank you for everyone being solutions focused, because we do believe that there is hope and there is light at the end of the tunnel, particularly in Philadelphia, right? If we can be the beacon for the rest of the nation, let's do so. So we're excited to get this conversation going. And trust me, you will hear from us again. So thank you on behalf of the Community College of Philadelphia.
Thank you.
Bye.